Good evening and welcome. I'm Justin Crowe, Associate Professor of Political Science and Chair of Leadership Studies here at Williams, and I'm thrilled to have you all here for our event, Election 2016. What's next? Tonight's program is part of the James McGregor Burns Distinguished Speaker Series, and we have two distinguished speakers to guide us tonight. But before we get to introducing and hearing from them, I wanted to remind you all about the series namesake. My apologies for those of you who heard some of this at our Burns Speaker Series panel on Barack Obama last November. James McGregor Burns, who passed away in July 2014, just a few weeks before his 96th birthday, is perhaps a name that not many of our students know today. But he is a man who left an indelible mark, not only on this place, which he loved as a student, an alumnus, and a faculty member, but also on his discipline, which he led and transformed, and on politics, which he influenced as an informal advisor to presidents and presidential aspirants. Jim graduated Williams in 1939, and after serving in the Army, where he was awarded a Bronze Star during World War II, earned a PhD from Harvard in 1947. He joined the faculty here that same year and subsequently became a scholar of national renown in his home discipline of political science, the cognate discipline of history, and the interdisciplinary field of leadership studies, of which Jim was a founder and chief intellectual inspiration. The author of more than 20 books, including Roosevelt, The Soldier of Freedom, for which he received both the Pulitzer Prize and the National Book Award, Jim was a prodigious scholar of the presidency specifically and the American political system more generally. Far from someone who only engaged politics from afar, he was also a four-time delegate to the Democratic National Convention and a one-time congressional candidate, running to represent the Massachusetts First, our district even today, in 1958. Jim lost that race, but gained a future subject and an attentive ear in then-Senator John F. Kennedy, whom Jim met while campaigning and whom he would shortly analyze in a biography and later advise on questions of party and presidential politics. It's not only because of his academic interests then, but also because of his life experiences that Jim would be fascinated to discuss this election. Just this morning, in fact, his daughter, Deb, sent me a photo of a poster advertising a talk Jim gave on campus in October 1987, entitled, "A Hell of a Way to Elect a President." I can only guess what colorful words he might have used in response to this election. But I don't need to guess whether or not he would have wanted to be part of the conversation about it. For according to every single alum who has ever told me, I took a course with James McGregor Burns, and there are a lot of them, he had an ironclad commitment to the mission of Williams as a community of teaching and learning, as a place where we grow closer by discussing together. It's in service of that vision, and with Jim's specific dedication to it in mind, that we have two distinguished public servants here to digest and dissect the election and its aftermath with us. First, Governor Jennifer Granholm. Elected Michigan's first female governor in 2002, Granholm is credited with transforming Michigan's economy in the midst of steady decline. 4 years later, she was reelected with the largest number of votes ever cast for a governor in the state. During her two terms as governor, Granholm, who had previously served as Michigan's attorney general, pioneered clean energy policies, signed into law a college prep curriculum for every high school student in the state, and launched the No Worker Left Behind program to provide job training to displaced Michigan employees. Since leaving the governor's office, she has taught law and public policy at the University of California, Berkeley, and served as an advisor to and advocate for Hillary Clinton's presidential campaign. Next, Senator Scott Brown. Brown served three terms in the Massachusetts House of Representatives and two terms in the state Senate. In 2010, he won the United States Senate seat that had become vacant upon the death of Ted Kennedy, making him the first Republican to represent the Commonwealth of Massachusetts in the Senate in more than three decades. Serving in the Senate until 2013, Brown developed a reputation as one of the most bipartisan members of the chamber and played an important role in both the Hire a Hero Act, providing tax benefits for employers that hire returning veterans, and the Stock Act, prohibiting insider trading for members of Congress. Upon leaving the Senate, Brown, who recently concluded 35 years of service in the Army National Guard, has remained active in politics, running for the Senate in New Hampshire and campaigning with various Republican candidates. I know it's been an extremely busy week and likely an incredibly exhausting season for the both of you, so I wanted to thank you sincerely for taking the time to join us this evening. It's an honor and pleasure to welcome you to Williams. Now, I recognize that this has been a contentious and divisive election season, and that many people are experiencing a range of raw emotions, but I just want to clarify that this is what this is intended to be tonight. And that's an opportunity to understand the election and some of the questions it raises from the perspective of seasoned politicians with some different views of the world. As a result, I've organized this not as a debate between a Democrat and a Republican about particular statements that may have been made or specific policy initiatives that may be pursued, but as a conversation with me asking Governor Granholm and Senator Brown some questions about the twists and turns of the campaign, about the mark it has left on our citizens and institutions, about the potential shape of American political life going forward, before we open it up to some questions from the floor. Afterward, there will be a reception, snacks, drinks, conversation in the lobby, and we hope you'll join us for that as well. And with that, let's begin the conversation. Thank you again to both of you for being here during an incredibly busy week.
Happy to be here. Actually, I should say that I almost canceled on Tuesday night because I was the co-chair of Hillary Clinton's transition team, and I had the audacity to think she was going to win. And so I called and said, you know, I may not be able to come. And so it's a bittersweet thing to be here, I'll just say that.
Well, I just want to say it's great to be here as well. I was actually met one of your professors, I believe he's here, and he said, you know, we're on opposite sides. I said, well, what do you mean? I thought he was talking about the fact that I went to Tufts and he's from Rome. So it's good to see you all. Thanks for coming. What a wonderful turnout.
So it's been almost 48 hours at this point since the outcome of the presidential election became more or less clear. In one sense, after a two-year campaign, that's not very long at all. But with all that has been written and said, felt and expressed since, it at least provides some distance and time to reflect. So as an opener, I wanted to know what stands out to each of you or resonates deeply with you now that didn't 2 days ago.
Well, I can...
Breathe, Governor, breathe.
I know, I'm breathe. So tempted to have just come draped in black. But to be honest, so since I'm from Michigan, right, Michigan has such a large manufacturing footprint and so many of the workers that ended up supporting Donald Trump. And so the thing that I take away from this, Professor Crowe, and I'm sure you guys may have looked at this and looked at the numbers on this, is that the Democratic Party used to speak for the workers who felt like they were not being seen. And it just breaks my heart that we, in this election, weren't able to speak to them in a way that was compelling. I say that, you know, as the governor of a state who's looked in the eyes of people who have cried because their job has been, you know, the rug has been pulled out from under them through no fault of their own. We have the biggest manufacturing footprint of any state in the country, and therefore we were hit the hardest. And those workers used to be Democrats. At least they used to vote for the Democratic Party. And in this election, it is a huge wake-up call for us. People who don't have a college degree, white, non-college degreed people, voted for Donald Trump with a 39-point margin. 39 points. They voted for Mitt Romney with a big margin too, but it was only 19 points. So that gap was just a precipice, and it is a wake-up call for us.
So in the last couple of days, what I have been most surprised and thankful for is the fact that you had Donald Trump, I thought, made a very good gesture and a respectful gesture towards Hillary Clinton and her service to our country. I worked with Hillary Clinton. I have a lot of respect for her personally. I was speaking to the governor and told her of some really truly life-saving things that I worked on with Hillary Clinton, and I've said this publicly, it's no secret. And I was also exceedingly thankful at the gracious concession speech presentation the next day that Hillary made, expressing the fact that she was thankful and that we are Americans first. And I was very hopeful today to hear the not only privately through my contacts, but also publicly, that the president and Donald Trump got together and they're acting as Americans first. Because let me ask you guys a question. I mean, are you a Democrat or a Republican or a Catholic or a Jew or a Muslim first? I think I'm an American first. I'm not a Republican first, I'm an American first. And the most important thing to me right now is to make sure that we put our country's interests first and move forward together. That's me. Now, is that other people? I don't know. I can tell you I was walking around here earlier. I met people and you know, they're wearing black, they're in mourning. Really? There's more to life than politics, folks. You know, there's more to life than politics. Do you have your health? Do you have a great education, amazing opportunities when you leave this great, great college? You know, do you have a lovely wife or husband sitting next to you or partner? I mean, that's what's important to me. And if we can try to kind of work together to move our country forward, that's what I'm trying to do and will continue to do.
So. Thank you. So one of the narratives...
Easy to say when you won.
I would have said that if... I'm just, you know, it's funny she says that because we talked earlier. Listen, I've run 21 times, okay? I've won some amazing races and I've lost a couple of tough races too. And in each and every occasion, I've been very gracious to the other person and expressed my, because it is, politics is a blood sport, guys. I guess you'd know that, right? And the reason that you have good people don't get involved anymore is because it's a blood sport. It's just too ugly.
One of the narratives that's been floating around for a few months and reemerged on Tuesday night was the idea that this was a quote-unquote change election. And on the one hand, Secretary Clinton aligned herself closely with President Obama, whose approval ratings have reached all-time highs, whereas President-elect Trump cast himself as an outsider who could offer a new perspective. And yet, at the same time, remarkably few seats in Congress, 7 or 8 in the House, depending on how some recounts go, 2 in the Senate, switched from one party to the other. I guess my question is this. With these sorts of conflicting pieces of information, how do we make sense of what voters are telling us?
Well, I think that people have had 8 years of one side, one policy, one area, one way to go, and they're looking for a change. They send, as the governor said, a very, very powerful message. He also had 52% of white women. He had 39% of Hispanics. You know, the fact that he wasn't going to get women, he wasn't going to get Hispanics, well, he did. And that's sending a very powerful message that, hey, hello, it's time to wake up and actually work to protect the union rights, you know, stop with Obamacare. You had union members, teachers, police officers, firefighters right now. And in Massachusetts, I voted for Romneycare. It passed 198-2. We had a great plan that allowed for competition, didn't raise taxes, you know, allowed for Commonwealth care for those here and the Cadillac plans. Well, those are gone as a result of Obamacare, and they're clicking in now. The deductibles are higher. So you're looking at a lot of those good union members, they're dying because of health care. They're dying because of the high corporate tax rates in the industrialized world compared to where we are. We can't be competitive, the overregulation. So they're looking for change. And the reason that they kept their senators and congressmen and wanted a Republican is because they want a different direction. And when I got there, the president had 2 years to do all the things. He could have done climate change, he could have done fair pay, he could have done minimum wage, and they didn't do it. They could have rammed it through. They had a supermajority, they did nothing. And then apparently when I got there, it's the Republicans' fault that we did nothing. Well, we have an opportunity now for 2 years to see what we can do. And I'm hopeful and I'm gonna keep an open mind and try to guide and assist and work and to try to address a lot of the things that your union brothers and sisters and others are concerned about.
I think that change is one of the narratives. What Hillary Clinton was saying is I wanna step on the gas and that would be change acceleration. I don't think personally the wrong track, right track numbers, where you've got 70% of people saying that the country's on the wrong track, I do not think that had to do solely with the president. I think that had to do with people looking, because of course the president's approval rating is like 56% right now. I think it had it to do with the fact that people did look at Congress as being obstructionist, that people, that to me was the, to me and to many people that I talked to, that was the wrong track. I think that many in Congress and Donald Trump took the wrong track number to mean it was only about the executive branch. People don't want to see obstruction. They want to see progress. And so I think that the change piece of things was that people saw their incomes having stagnated, despite the fact that there was a bump last year, which was good, and despite the fact that the unemployment rate is down below what it was before the recession, and that he had cut it in half. There were this group of people I'm talking about that populate Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. They don't feel that, and they wanted to know what was going to be the change for me. And to Donald Trump's credit, he went in there and he talked about trade. And for our people, that trade thing is massive. I used to campaign on NAFTA and CAFTA have given us the SHAFTA, because for us,
clever,
that was true. It was very simple, but it was really, it was very true. And this is why Bernie Sanders won in Michigan, because he was so clear about that. And when Donald Trump came in and defied Republican orthodoxy by going at the trade issue, that caused people to sit up and take notice. And I think that was the change that people were looking for. I want a change in my economic circumstances. I think it had less to do with changing the, you know, it's changing the political party and the presidency than it did changing my economic circumstances and perhaps sending a message that Congress should not be obstructing.
You've both sort of mentioned your party and what might be different. You said, you know, party needs to change. Senator Brown, you said now our party has a chance to lead. I wanted to talk to each of you about your respective parties, which I think face different challenges over the months and year ahead. So first, for Governor Granholm on the Democrats, the seeming struggle that you mentioned to connect with white working class voters this cycle has led a bunch of people to have these kind of overwrought, in my opinion, hand-wringing episodes about the future of the party. I had a student today in class. Julia, are you here?
Call her out.
Jeez. Oh, Julia, you would have just gotten extra credit. All right. Well, Julia mentioned an article.
She's raising her hand over here.
There she is. Julia mentioned an article from The Atlantic that was saying, you know, the Democrats are done as a party. And I said, that's kind of ridiculous and overwrought and hyperbolic. But I want to know what lessons you think the party will or should take from this election. Right? If you were chairwoman of the Democratic National Committee, and despite your protestations that you have no interest in the job, people keep saying you're a front runner for it, how would you suggest the party shape its message or think about constructing a winning coalition heading into 2020?
I would say two things. I would say you continue to build the coalition, meaning that you continue to reach out to millennials and give them a reason to show up at the polls, that you continue to hold on to the policies that keep women engaged, and she did win women by 12 points. You continue to create a coalition of this new rising American majority. You do all of that, and you speak to the economic woes. You speak to it with your gut. You have to say to people, I get it. You have to put policies in place that create middle-class jobs, that create economic clusters for people to be able to work in. She did. She had this wrath of policies that she had put in place, but whether it was the fact that she had so many policies that she talked about that people couldn't hang on to the one. And for any of you who ever run for office, the sort of MO of running for office is you say you're going to do three things because that's what people can remember. And she had, you know, a laundry list of things, and so it was difficult to latch onto one. So Democrats can talk about people who are unseen, whether it's that worker or people of color, or people who are unseen in the boardrooms, or people who are unseen in the heights of power. People can talk about that. I mean, Democrats should be able to continue to amass that. So both of those things, The standing, the stronger together, the fantastic American diversity and jobs. Those two things have to be our mantra.
Sounds like a future chairwoman of the DNC
to
me.
No. The DNC chair should be someone who represents that rising American majority.
Next, for Senator Brown on the Republicans. Obviously, parties always prefer to win elections rather than to lose them. But winning and transitioning from campaigning to governing brings new challenges to the fore. That will surely be even more challenging than usual, given the president-elect's outsider status and the fact that many Republicans sought to distance themselves from him. I know President-elect Trump and Speaker Ryan have pledged to work together for the good of the party, but I wonder how exactly you think they'll do that, given their sometimes bitter personal disagreements during the campaign and their pretty meaningful policy disagreements about issues ranging from entitlement reform to immigration.
Well, you can policy people to death. You know, policies are great, but with all due respect, Governor, people need jobs. And you can talk to them about all these wonderful things you're going to do, but if you have high corporate tax rates, you have, you know, incredible regulation, you have, you know, just one obstacle after another, you have, what are you guys paying, $60,000 now? When I was at Tufts, just capped $10,000. $60,000, really? I mean, that's an amazing amount of money. So you got to see if you're going to get that value back. And when you leave here, what do you want? You want a job, a good job. It's not, you don't want a good policy. You want to be able to go out and actually go get a job and make some great money and have a family and move on. And when you're coming about transition and dealing with people that you don't like, yeah, listen, I was the 41st senator. I stopped the Obama agenda cold. And I remember walking into the Oval Office as Donald Trump did today and saying, oh my goodness, I can't believe I'm in the Oval Office. This is amazing. And I'm listening to the president. I said, I can't believe he's here either, you know? Because we are both good people. We both are wonderful people. He's a great family man. He's got great kids. I'm a good family man. I have great kids. But we look at things so incredibly differently. You know, when he was saying, Scott, what would you do to actually get the economy moving? I said, oh, Mr. President, that's easy. We've got to lower corporate tax rates. We've got to repatriate all that offshore money. We've got to streamline regulation. We have to lower tuition in colleges. We have to create an incentive for people to grow and hire and expand. And right now there's a wet blanket. And he's saying, well, that's not true. We actually got to do $1 trillion stimulus. We got to push Obamacare. We got to put more regulation. And so we were like in two different planets. So when you're talking about politics and strange bedfellows, I just refer you back to the two most incredible men, I think, from Massachusetts and Washington, Tip O'Neill and Ronald Reagan. You know, they battled till they were blue in the face. And then at night, they go grab a scotch and play some cards and work out our country's problems. And as I was saying to the governor earlier, that doesn't happen anymore. You know, that
doesn't
happen.
Wait, but he's talking about your party. Can I ask you a question?
I'm talking about our party because you're saying the question was how is Speaker Ryan? You know, I guess it's almost like two parties. You got the Trumpians. Yeah. It's a different party within our party. You got strange bedfellows. Yes, it's Democrat and Republican with the reference I made, but it's really two different parties now. You have the leader of the new Republican Party, which is Donald Trump, and you have Paul Ryan, which is the establishment.
And
it's
you have the
same
libertarians.
Thing.
You got Rand.
You've
Paul,
got free staters. You got libertarians. You got conservatives, fiscal conservatives, social conservatives. You got moderates, liberals. Yeah.
So how's all that going to work, yeah. Senator?
Listen, the same way it's worked since the founding of our country. Democracy's messy, folks. It's not easy. It's supposed to be messy. Our founding fathers made it messy. Remember, they used to have duels, okay, in the Senate floor.
Are you proposing that for the Speaker and the President-elect?
I like that.
I think the key to our relationship is you have Vice President-elect Pence, who is very friendly and very, very close with the Speaker. And they have already found common ground. I know that for a fact. I know the things that they're going to be working on initially. And then they're going to work on the things they agree upon and get that done, and then they'll figure out where they go from there. It's just no different than when you came in and you tried to find, and you passed some pretty amazing legislation in your state with a complete and total domination by the Republicans. You found a way to make it happen, and that's what you have to do. That's what democracy is all about.
It's going to be interesting, though, I think, just from an intellectual point of view, where you've got Donald Trump, who's more on the authoritarian side, right? He's very much law and order. He wants to, you know, have big military, et cetera. And on the other side, you've got the libertarians who, you know, who want no military engagement.
The deficit hawks.
Right, and the deficit hawks versus, I mean, well, Donald Trump
aggressive guy. He's more like Bernie Sanders in that regard.
Well,
he's
stepping back. But so within the spectrum of the Republican Party, you have these antithetical views. I mean, the Democrats, we have shades of differences, but we all want to make sure that we bring down the cost of college. We all are in the same sort of realm. You guys have got people who are like, woo! Yeah,
well, with all due respect, I know Bernie Sanders, okay? He's very far left. He's a socialist. And I also know Mark Warner and Joe Manchin, who are far right in your party. So they have, you know, the same
thing
in the Republican
Party. But Mark Warner and Joe Manchin would be supportive of the idea of bringing down the cost of college. They would be supportive of making sure that people have access to affordable
health care. Every Republican I know wants to bring down the cost of college. They want to find a way to pay for it.
Yeah. They don't want
to. Sorry, we own $20 trillion with a T, $1 trillion national debt, kids. It's not me. It's you and your grandkids are going to pay for it. We have to find a way to
pay
down
the debt
deficit. And
your guy is going to increase that by $13 trillion.
You can do all the sound bites you want.
I'm just saying, it's not sound bites.
You can do all the sound bites you want, but when you repatriate almost $3 trillion immediately, you're going to get a non-governmental stimulus that's going to offset and pay for some of the programs, especially the reconstruction program that he's offering. That will be the pay for.
So there was a great deal of talk on Tuesday about, I mean, we could keep going like that, or speaking about,
of the political map,
red states and blue states, safe states and swing states. For President-elect Trump, there was obvious success in the Rust Belt and the industrial Midwest, recovering Ohio and flipping Wisconsin and Michigan to the Republican column. I know, I'm sorry, Governor.
Breathe, Governor, breathe.
I know.
For Secretary Clinton, it was harder to find successes there, but there were gains made in a state like Texas, which Democrats have long hoped to turn purple. Where do you each see meaningful changes in the political map going forward? You're both involved in the party. You're both former elected officials. Are there places we should look to as new battlegrounds in 21st century America, or places where you think your respective parties would be wise to invest more time and resources in convincing voters of your message?
Totally. Totally in this new American majority. I mean, the Latino vote is going to be critical. It's obviously the largest growing demographic. If, Latino registration was up, participation was up enormously. It didn't overcome the loss of the white, non-college educated voters or the dip in African-American support from President Obama, but that is completely the rising demographic that for the Democrats we've got to continue to focus on. And from a policy perspective, I think to appeal to that, there has to be a recognition that Democrats should be the party of, for example, small business. A lot of the ethnic communities are very focused on small businesses, and to be able to put forth policies that create jobs for small businesses, I think, is really an opportunity for us.
So when you're DNC chairwoman, it's going to be Arizona and Texas?
From a geographic point of view, Texas for sure. I mean, I was talking with, is it Paloma? I can't remember her name. Are you here?
Paloma?
Yes, Paloma. You know, she who's from Texas, and I was saying to her, what's the date at which we can find a tipping point for Texas to turn blue? She was looking a little bit further out than I was, being more realistic, as she says. But I think that Texas and, of course, Arizona, I think that all of this, even in Michigan, there's 5% Latinos in Michigan, and that is still a growing population. So in almost every state where there is, especially Latinos in Michigan, we also have obviously Muslim Americans as well, which were very important. But I think pockets, ethnic groups that are growing are our opportunity in every state.
What about you, Senator Brown?
So the Chambers of Commerce and virtually every small business group endorsed Donald Trump because small businesses recognize that this isn't JFK's or Bill Clinton's party anymore. There's a tremendous amount of overregulation and onerous challenges for any small business to stay open now, period. I mean, it's a fact. And if you've ever run a small business, you know what I'm talking about. You wake up in the middle of the night wondering whether you can pay the bills. Well, who are you going to have to let go because you can't afford to turn on the lights or pay the insurance or pay the regulatory nightmare that's coming down from every unelected, unaccountable bureaucrat who's trying to, you know, change the way you do business? And I said to the governor, I'm in favor of regulation, but it needs to be good common sense legislation, not just to justify your job. And so when you're talking, Governor, about, you know, well, you know, the Democrats, they're not. That's why the small business owners went Republican this time, because of the amazing burdens that have been put on small business. And one thing
he's
that's
asking
really,
about where you would grow, though.
Well, I'm getting there. But one thing that's really bugging me, okay, and it's bugged me long before this election is, and just you kind of, and I like you a lot, and I think you make a great DNC chair.
I hear a but.
Well, the Latinos this, and the African Americans that, and the whites this, and the, you know, the Muslims here, and the Democrats here, and the really, the labels are killing me. You know, we're going to go after the Latino vote. They're going to be with us because of this, and we're going to go after the black vote because, you know, we, you know, I'm sorry, I'm done. I've been done. I was done when I ran the last time and the time before that. I want you to vote whether you're black, white, green, Martian, I don't care. You're an American first. I want to make sure that we put an America first and an America together for everybody. And this division that we're doing on both sides has got to stop. That's part of the basic problem with us as a society. We're, oh, so you're an African American. Hey, what do we got in common? We have basketball in common. I was the captain of the Tufts basketball team. I love basketball. We can talk about the Sixers and Celtics all day. All
but
day.
You
so
guys,
we found
wait,
common
wait,
ground.
Please,
I'm tired, I mean, of the divisions.
But no,
tired.
I'm talking about unity. I'm talking about a country that represents
we're not
going to
have
us.
Unity,
but
Governor,
hey,
unless we stop with the divisions.
But wait a second. But then you guys did an autopsy at the end of the last presidential election, which said that you've got to do more to listen and to reach out to communities of color. And you got a candidate that did the exact opposite. I mean, he alienated people.
Listen.
He caused people to flee. So
he also got 39% of the Latino vote, as you referenced, and he wasn't supposed to get any. He was supposed to be single digits. You also had a strong African-American turnout for him as well, because they recognized that he is going to help create jobs. And that's what's more important. It's about jobs and putting money in people's pocketbooks and wallets. And my candidate, yeah, I supported him. I don't agree with him on everything. I've said that publicly. I'm a Scott Brown Republican, as I expect you guys to be, you know, members of your own, you know, societies when you go out. I vote on the issues that I feel are important. I do what I feel is right for my country, for my state, for my own personal well-being. But there are many... Listen, I've been there, you've been there, you know there are many divisive people on both sides of the aisle, and we can pick off names left and right in the public persona, privately, you know, so we're going to just continue to say, well, he said this, and she said that, and he said this. Listen, it's over.
Do you think, though, that, I'm sorry to interrupt.
No,
just,
please.
Just a quick question, then I'll let you get back.
I didn't get elected the governor of Michigan, please.
The issue... the issue of comprehensive immigration reform. I mean, this is something that is really important to a lot of people.
Yeah, it should be.
And I'm glad to hear you say that it should be. So you had a bipartisan bill in the Senate. It was flawed in some ways, but at least it was through in a bipartisan way. Do you expect that you'll see some comprehensive immigration reform with this president-elect?
So what was the problem with the bill? Do you know what the problem was?
Tell me what you think the problem was.
I know what the problem was. The problem was that you have people here illegally that during that whole process, they would still continue to get benefits that they weren't entitled to and they haven't earned. And that was the problem with getting majority support and having it actually come to the floor and passing.
Do you think, though, that a path to citizenship is something that your party will champion now that they have control of all three branches of government?
Well, you're going to need to secure the border. You need to secure the border.
So
as Mexico,
you're going to get Mexico to pay for the wall.
You can throw out the sound bite so we can have a good conversation.
No.
Mexico has a wall on their other border. We're entitled to have a secure border. I believe that it's very important, and so does every member of the Senate that I'm aware of.
So
and
if you
every
get that wall,
has,
do you think that you can have you, a comprehensive
there's a whole lot of things you need to do first, Governor. Let me finish.
And to think this started as a question about the political map.
I'm so sorry.
You need to secure the border. I don't care who pays for it, but it needs to be done. because we are a country of laws. Every other country has a system. And I am somebody who is supportive of immigration, will continue to do that, understand it very, very, very well. We need to have e-verification. We need to make sure that we provide opportunities and penalties for businesses who are hiring people illegally. When you have this administration taking people who have actually not followed the law and putting them ahead of almost 4 million people that have actually done the right thing, they've filled the forms out, they've hired the attorneys, they've been in line upwards of 10 years, and to have people who have basically, because of some political opportunity, been put in front of all those 4 million people, I think that's wrong. I think we should process all the people who are in line, following the law, doing the right thing, get them in here as quickly as possible because the system is broken. Is it, well, they need more computers? Great, let's get them. They need more approving authorities or judges? Great, let's do it. But, you know, throwing lip service at it and once again dividing people, you know, because, oh, you don't want this and you don't want that, you're against, you're a racist, you're a bigot. Really? No, I want to process the people who are following the laws first. I want to secure the border, have e-verification, take care of the people who are doing it first, and then the people who are here illegally, I want to get rid of the criminals. I think that they're here and they're hurting and killing people, and they shouldn't be here over and over and over, breaking and hurting and maiming and killing our citizens. I think that's appropriate. And when you're talking, hey, what do we do with the rest of the folks? What do we do with them? That's the issue I think you're really talking about. Let's cut the crap here. I mean, you're really talking about that. I'm not sure. And that's what the people have been elected to actually come forward and do. Is there a process, as Marco had tried to do, to say, you know what? You're going to get some type of identification that allows you to file and pay taxes. You're going to be able to get in the back of the line. And during, here's the key, and here's why that bill failed. I know it firsthand because I spoke, and Marco and I worked on it for a long, long time. Is during that process of then being in the back of the line, paying taxes, following the law, they can't get the benefits that citizens who have, and the people who have followed the law are getting. They can't get all the free stuff, all the benefits. If you guaranteed that, I believe it would have passed. If you guaranteed that during that process, you took that away, it would have passed.
So we've got lots of disagreements on small business, on immigration, and other things. One thing the parties seem to agree about, even if for different reasons this cycle, was the media. President-elect Trump was obviously sharply critical of the way the media covered him, mostly on Twitter, routinely expressing disapproval of the New York Times, the failing New York Times, the CNN, and other news outlets. On the other side, Democrats lamented that Secretary Clinton was held to a different and much higher standard than her opponent, and that the media allowed an obsessive focus on celebrity and scandal to subsume any substantive discussion of policy. I'm less interested in kind of relitigating those particular claims than in thinking about how the media covers and depicts politics today. As one-time candidates, as former office holders, how much do you find yourself responding to or frustrated by the media? Do you feel as though the media is offering a distorted view to Americans about what the political process, what partisanship, what bipartisanship look like? Governor?
Yeah, I do. I think, you know, I'm somebody who's on a lot, you're on a lot. I am frustrated by the, you know, the talking head panels where you have one from each side and all...
Present company excluded.
No, I'm frustrated by, when we're on, I'm frustrated by that, you know? I think that it is so unhelpful to have this sort of false equivalency on issues where you've got to have one side and the other side when sometimes things are just so obvious that you don't need to always have point counterpoint. And that's true in the print as well as on TV. I'm also frustrated by the fact that people don't cover policy. It's so frustrating to know that there were 15,000 mentions of email. I mean, which is, you know, certainly it's an issue. I'm not saying that it's not, but relative to every three mentions of any kind of policy, that to me is really frustrating because. On my candidate's policies, which I thought were fantastic, never got a mention. I mean, they just didn't get a mention at all, unless you were totally digging into the websites. So I wish that the media could focus more on policy. I know that people's eyes glaze over. And so the question for them is, how do you be creative enough to make it interesting for people to follow policy? And because it affects them personally, you know, so that would be my frustration.
Senator Brown, the media?
I've always battled with the media, being a Republican. I'm probably one of the only Republicans in this room right now. So, you know, I understand what it's like to be in the minority. I was saying to the governor, when I was a senator in Massachusetts, we had 5 Republicans out of 40 in the Senate. And as a state rep, we had 22 out of 160. So, you know, there is a natural bias because the Democrats are in charge. They control all the federal offices. They control the legislature, the media. There's a kind of a very cozy relationship. And you see what happened with Donna, you know, and giving questions and initially saying she didn't do it. And then actually she did do it. And she's kind of proud that she did it. You know, the ordinary folks are saying, you know what, we don't mind you guys battling, you know, the Democrats and Republicans battling. But we at least want it to be fair. We don't want any, like, inside baseball, wink, wink, nod, nod, you know. And I think the media, all media, and I work for Fox, all media has lost that kind of neutrality that we expect. I mean, the Walter Cronkite standard, who, my wife works in the media. She's a news reporter. She worked for Channel 5 for 25 years. She's still working. And that kind of Walter Cronkite, where you just say, it's fair and it's not biased and he's the guy. That's the standard we need to get back to.
I have one more question I want to ask, and then I want to throw it open to the audience. Looking forward a bit, yesterday, both Secretary Clinton and President Obama emphasized the importance of coming together as a nation, of working together for goals that are worth pursuing, of seeking to improve the lives of all Americans. And yet this campaign season, characterized as it was by some strident rhetoric, has obviously opened up a number of wounds. And whichever way the election went, likely would have provoked consternation among the other candidates' supporters. So, as veterans of many campaigns, I wonder if you have any advice on how Americans of whatever partisan stripe can balance working for the common good, fighting for what they believe in, and taking seriously the perspective of the other side. Senator?
So my philosophy was that I'd read the bills, see how they affected our state, our country, and debt and deficit and vote, regardless of who the sponsor was, regardless of what it meant politically, as long as it made sense and hit those 5 standards, I slept very well at night. I'm not quite sure where we're going to head, quite honestly, but I'm from this philosophy, a school of philosophy also, like Tip O'Neill and Ronald Reagan, that I will battle with you till I'm blue in the face. I will go tooth and nail. We will go toe-to-toe, beating each other's faces respectfully, based on fact. But at the end of the day, I want to go have a pizza and a beer with you. Talk about the kids. Talk about the Celtics, you know, basketball. You know, find that common ground. What do we actually agree on? Like, what do we actually agree on? Can we actually just work on those things first? And so what I try to do is, even with Al Franken or with, you know, John Kerry or with, you know, Carl Levin, you know, finding those, you know, with John Kerry and I was saying to the governor, you know, we didn't really agree on a heck of a lot, but we were avid bicyclists. We would go out for 100-mile bike rides, and we worked with Warner and Portman. 4 of us would go out, and we had different cliques within the Senate that we could go back and report as to what we were doing. There were many times, one of them was I talked about the nuclear deal with Russia, and then there was another one, we were about to shut down the government again, and we had the ability to go for the first 50 all out, and then the next 50 just kind of, you know, riding on our seats, hands on our handlebars, and just talk about, okay, what are we going to do when we get back? Are we going to go and, like, so I had my group, and he had his group, and we actually went back and went to work and actually did our jobs. So that's what I'm hopeful will happen, and it really, you guys are in the minority now, and you've been in the minority for a little bit, and there's an opportunity for Chuck Schumer to really come together and find that common ground. If is it infrastructure? Maybe that's the one thing that will actually bring us together initially, finding a way to fix our road and bridges. Well, how do you pay for it? So you guys aren't now up to $23 or $4 trillion national debt. I think that the best way to pay for that is to repatriate immediately that offshore money, give X amount for reemployment, Y amount for recapitalizing your company or buying back stock, a Z amount for doing clean energy projects, but to keep it overseas and not bring it back is just like so ridiculous. It's an $3 trillion non-governmental stimulus that'll pay for the things we're talking about. So there are solutions. We just have to figure out that common ground and actually find a way to do it.
And actually, I agree with him. I think that we can have common ground on immigration. I do. Immigration and on repatriation. I think we can have common ground on figuring out how to keep manufacturing, advanced manufacturing in America. I think we could have common ground on streamlining regulations so that small business owners can flourish. I think we could find common ground on criminal justice reform. There are Democrats and Republicans who really want to see criminal justice reform. I think we can find common ground on a spate of things if we are respectful of one another.
So here's, and then we'll get to your questions. Listen, we have all night, so it's up to you guys. So when I was there, right, the first year, I didn't get an office for like 3 or 4 weeks. First of all, I held up my swearing in for 3 weeks so they could send an interim senator down there to ram through Obamacare. All right, so that's in Massachusetts. I get there and Harry Reid, I'm supposed to get the Kennedy office, one of the best offices. They said, oh, we need to repaint it, you know, because it's filled with lead paint. Oh, really? Well, Kennedy's been in there for 50 years. It was all right for him. But it's not all right for me because I'm the new guy. Okay, great.
Maybe he was just being nice to you, son.
Yeah. And then I didn't get an office. I was in a trailer for like a month. No phones, no computers. And finally, Harry Reid says to me, hey, Senator, how's it going? I said, you know what, Mr. Leader? It's not going too well. Let me tell you something. I could be the 41st senator and hold up everything in this building for a year and a half till, you know, we have the next session. Or I could be the 60th senator and actually move and work with you to get things done. If I don't get effing phones and computers and staff by like tomorrow, I'm going to be the 41st senator. And Harry Reid, I got it, obviously, but when I was there the first year, we only voted on eight bills. The next year it was like 12, and the next year it was like 14 bills. So Harry, and we talked about this at dinner, would actually move a bill forward, move for cloture, all right, fill the amendment tree and not let Republicans come in. And so we did nothing for 3 years in terms of anything substantial. And that's why a lot of his Democratic colleagues lost, because they didn't have any amendments, no bills to go. Begich, great guy. He lost. He got crushed because he didn't have a record. So when you're talking about moving forward in obstructionism, it's on both sides. The one thing that Mitch McConnell has done, whether you like him or not, you can ask Chuck Schumer, ask your congressmen or your senators in particular, what has he done? He's gone back to regular order that Harry Reid did not do, which allows for the committee process to start, to go through the appropriations process, to have amendments, hearings at the committee level. They take a bill, they move it out of committee, they bring it to the floor, you get amendments, and you work through the process, and you get a product that's actually a darn good product. They did some good things in the last couple of years that didn't happen when Harry Reid was in charge. So Chuck Schumer has an amazing opportunity. You want to unite the Democratic Party? Get this economy moving and get people working again and make everybody kind of feel better about themselves, and he'll have a very good legacy.
Do you want to respond, Governor? Or
no, I mean, let's go to the audience.
Okay, I want to open this all up. Before I do, I just request that you limit yourself to a single question rather than a series of questions or question preceded by extensive comment. I understand that many of you have many thoughts and questions about this election, but it's precisely because so many of you have thoughts that I'd like to keep us moving and see if we can get to as many as possible. And I remind you that we try to reserve the first few questions for students. So, students in the audience, who has a question? Yeah.
Hi, my name is Jane Peterson. I'm from Ann Arbor, Michigan.
You are!
My question is for you, Governor. This is an issue that was important at the beginning of the year, but as the election came closer and closer, kind of got forgotten about. What are we going to do about Flint?
The question is, what are we going to do about Flint? And I know you all followed this, right? But the issue right now in Flint is how you replace these pipes that are lead pipes, right? And it's not just Flint, of course. It's in Cleveland. It's in other places. And this is why when we talk about infrastructure, the infrastructure doesn't just have to be roads and bridges. It can be replacing underground pipes to make sure that kids are not drinking poisoned water. And I think this is the question for the president-elect, is what does he mean by infrastructure? Can we, one of the members of Congress has a bill which is called a 10-20-30 bill, where you put 10% of the money into populations where it's where you've had 20% of the population in poverty for 30 years or more. So you reserve a focus of federal dollars to areas that are in the highest needs. That could be Flint, it could be rural areas, but you want to focus on high poverty populations. That to me is something that could appeal across the board as well, because there are a lot of rural and Republican representing areas, as well as areas like Flint. That has to be a priority, because what happened in Flint is a crime, and it was really done because I think, and this is my editorial on it, the leadership of the state, when they put in an emergency manager who made the decision to switch the water from Lake Michigan, which is glacial water, to the Flint River, which has historically been sort of an industrial dumping ground to save money, they did it. And they didn't put any corrosion control in the pipes when they made that switch. And river water causes corrosion much more quickly than the waters of Lake Michigan or Lake, in this case, Lake Huron. That decision was so horrific and compounded by the fact that the leadership knew that this was happening and let it simmer for way too long of a period of time. That's the backstory. The forward story is the pipes have to be ripped out and replaced. And it's not just Flint, but in other areas of the country.
So I would just, can I add something to that? I would be shocked if that is not addressed in a infrastructure bill. Just shocked. Because we do have in Boston, you know, in other parts, I wouldn't be shocked if it's downtown Pittsfield, you have some issues as well. So that's my hope. I'm certainly encouraged, and from what I'm hearing, that many different folks who have interests will have a voice at the table in that regard. And I think it would be helped along if there's almost a public-private partnership in those repairs. What do I mean by that? The ability for private businesses and industries in that area to participate in the financing and payment of those, in addition to the state and federal government, so everybody has a stake, everybody has an interest. I think that's the new norm in providing financing and issues, financing and federal government helping. It needs to be a public-private partnership. You get the best bang for your dollar.
I hope you're right about that, because I know the Republicans in the Senate blocked it last time, so that would be great if they came around.
Other questions?
Well, I wasn't there, so yeah.
Probably, on the balcony there, all the way in the back. Is that you, Miranda?
Yeah. Hi. My name is Miranda. My question is for the senator. In the last few days, you said that in his first 100 days, Donald Trump should repeal and replace Obamacare. My question is, how much of it would be repealed, and what do you see the replacement being?
Well, I just want to repeat the question, Senator, so everyone can
hear.
Yeah, sure. The question
was about... I said that the first 100 days, Obamacare should be repealed and replaced. That was the question. And I was against Obamacare, and let me tell you why. We had in Massachusetts Romney Care. People say, oh, Obamacare and Romney Care are the same thing. No, they're not. Romney Care passed 198-2. Obamacare was rammed through reconciliation to circumvent the traditional rules on a major thing like that, holding up my election to put it in. You know all the shenanigans and machinations they went through. Romney Care didn't raise 18 new taxes, take $750 billion from our seniors' Medicare. You see what's happening now with the Cadillac plans and the whole host of things. In Romney Care, we had catastrophic care and coverages. We had pre-existing care and coverages in our plan. I believe that the states can do it better. You look at the post office, you look at the VA, you look at a lot of the entities run by the federal government, and they don't do it well. The post office is in billions of dollars of debt. The VA people are dying. So I believe that everybody should have the ability to either have or purchase health care. So let's start with that. I supported Romney Care. I was one of the people who actually worked on the umbilical, the stem cell umbilical stem cells and other parts of that health care bill, so felt very strongly about it. I want to make sure that we actually put it back to the states. And when they say repeal, get rid of Obamacare, replace it with things that work for the states in particular, with the federal government incentivizing the states to actually do in either certain things better or more than they otherwise would, as we do through the Medicare waivers in Massachusetts. Massachusetts, I think, just got a $400 million Medicare waiver to help pay for the program here in Massachusetts. Don't forget, I'm speaking parochially because we're in Mass, we have the Commonwealth Care that takes care of the people who can't afford it. They have health care. We also have the Cadillac plans that those police officers and others negotiated, or large corporations that say, we don't want them to go to Facebook. We want them to come over here to Amazon. So we're going to give them not only great health care plan, we pay for everything. Well, that's you get penalized now for that. So I think we can do it better at the local level, and that's, I think, the difference.
Governor, do you want to say anything about Obamacare?
I'm going to, I have so much to say on that. I worry that I'm not going to be able to get to the next question, but let me just say this. I do think that Obamacare needs to have continual improvement, and there are opportunities to fix some of the things that you're talking about, but to completely repeal it and to replace it with just allowing the states to do their own thing was essentially what existed before Obamacare. And you would be ripping 20 million people out from having health care. All of you who are on your parents' insurance, that would no longer be the case. So I don't think that that's what's going to happen, because I think there would be too much of an outcry for ripping that out. I think it's a good talking point. I do think everybody wants to see if we can get to yes on health care that addresses pre-existing conditions, that keeps young people on their parents' health care system, and that does not rip 20 million people off of the system. I would say, I think your Massachusetts plan, it's because the governor expanded Medicaid. Other states have not done that.
No, this was Governor Romney. This was back when Governor Romney did it.
But you guys have expanded Medicaid. You have taken the expansion. You've done the Medicaid expansion, of course, which makes perfect sense. But there are a bunch of states that have not. If you leave it to go just back to the states, that kind of patchwork would exist. So people who are unfortunate enough to be living in red states, you would see governors perhaps not doing something. And so that's not really, I think, who we are as a nation. I think we want to be able to join the rest of the globe. Most countries, certainly advanced countries, have been able to figure this out. And if we revert, I think we will go backwards in terms of how we care for our citizens.
So I need to add, I'm sorry, just to finish this, because...
Quickly, Senator, because I want to...
Well, listen, this is an important issue, and it's a great question. When I was there, we filed about 300 amendments to fix it, okay? Because remember, there was a plan with the House, a plan with the Senate. They couldn't merge them. We had 300 amendments to fix it. So when they say, we want to fix it, they had 300 opportunities to do it, and they voted against. Harry Reid did not allow them to come up, and they voted against every single one of them. And when you're talking about pre-existing care and coverages and a lot of the things you're referencing, you can do that in a state plan, and you're going to have better people in more local areas directing that health care plan specifically to you and your needs in that state, because not every state is different. This one-size-fits-all to health care and every other thing is not the way that
but
we should be doing
size.
Things.
I mean,
if you,
really
if you want to go to other countries to get health care, then go. Go to Canada, go to Mexico, because I will take this health care over any other health care in the entire world.
Because you have health care. Because you have health care.
All right, another question. Anything on the upper balcony? No? All right, all the way at the back in the blue plaid shirt. No.
Wait, down
here.
Or?
Down here. You're,
they're
you,
both
right
plaid
there.
Shirts.
Not you, Noah.
Okay.
Senator Scott Brown, during your lovely presentation, you said, you know what it feels like to be the minority. Could you sort of talk about what that exactly means to you?
Sure.
The question, by the way, was what Senator Brown means by saying he knows what it means to be a minority.
Well, obviously, you're an African-American, so you're trying to say somehow that I don't understand what your situation is. I was speaking strictly political and being a minority party member. But just to talk about my life, and which you may not know, my mom and dad were married and divorced 4 times each. I lived in 17 houses by the time I was 18. My mom was on welfare. I'm a survivor of sexual abuse, okay, and a tremendous amount of violence in my family. So you want to talk about a minority? Yeah, I'm a minority compared to every other white person who went through that type of life. You want to talk about stations in life, but can I understand what you and your family and your history have gone through? Absolutely not. But have I worked to provide opportunities for people of color and others? Absolutely, and I feel very proud of where I stand and what I have done in that regard.
Yeah, in the black coat right here.
Question for both. My name's Elise Chavez. I'm from Plymouth, Kansas, Michigan.
Great.
I never knew we had so many Michigan.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's so great.
So this is sort of a question for both, but it's better about, I want to feel like an American first, but I'm a Latino woman. And the rhetoric of the president-elect campaign has told me to leave this country, and also that I'm essentially a pussy to be grabbed if I'm hot enough. So it's really hard for me at the moment to feel like an American first. And I would really, like, I'm here for answers. Like, I want to know how I'm regaining that.
Okay, so the question, just in case anyone couldn't hear, was about how you feel like an American first, given some of the things that were said about women and Latinos by the president-elect. Have I summarized it more or less accurately? Okay.
There's a tremendous amount of rhetoric on both sides. It was it different with Donald Trump in certain things? Yeah, absolutely. Did I speak out against those things? Yes, I did. Do I agree with them on it? No, I don't. All I would ask is that what I know about the people he's surrounding himself with in the process of doing, that they are good people and that he will delegate to those individuals the ability to do his or her job. And all I can suggest to you is recognize that politics is a blood sport. It's changed even since I first ran back in 1985. And with people like you and others to, you know, be able to battle like we're doing. We're going to probably go have a drink after, you know. We're going to battle, but we're also going to communicate like human beings. That's missing. So I said my mom and dad were married and divorced 4 times each. I remember growing up saying, I will never, ever, ever, ever do the things that my dad did, ever, ever. And I have been married 30 years. So I'm suggesting to you is that recognizing that you will never, ever, ever, ever do, and a lot of you guys here, or say the things that have been said, and learn from those, and, you know, work towards, you know, bringing people together and get involved and be a little bit patient. And, you know, it's only been a couple of days. Everyone just take a chill pill, okay? Just let it develop, and let's see if the democracy and people can kind of, you know, get their heads on straight and kind of figure it out.
I agree. You got to wait for a couple of days, but don't you think after a couple of days or a week that there has to be some statement on the part of this next president that addresses these issues, which have really caused deep pain on the part of many? The fact that there's no recognition of what he has said that has hurt people, I think, makes it more difficult to bring people together. And then, you know, he's put on his team, and they're now talking about this fellow being the chief of staff, this Steve Bannon, who is head of Breitbart, which of course is the voice
There's
of
a lot
the,
of talk out there, Governor.
Of the alt-right.
You know that.
Well, okay, but he was the chairman of his campaign, and you could see him coming into the administration. And the concern that so many would have, and I speak for myself, is that kind of mindset is what's going to be in his ear all the time and dictating policy. Don't you think, I mean, you're somebody who maybe you would be in the administration. I mean, maybe you could have a whisper in his ear about how important it is to use language that's inclusive and policies that are inclusive, and maybe build a cabinet and an administration that represents and looks like America.
Yeah, well, you need to be patient, because obviously it started this morning when the president and the vice president elects and president met. It starts today. It started when Donald Trump said what he said and what Hillary Clinton said what she said. They're setting an amazingly wonderful example for us all, I think. And I'm deeply encouraged by that. And we've talked about that a little bit as well. I've whispered in his ear. I've yelled in his ear. I've been, you know, and, you know, he listens to some things. He doesn't listen to other things. The people have spoken. They voted. The beauty of it is guess what? In 2 years, you can change the Senate, you know, or change Congress. In 4 years, you can change the president. This is democracy. You have these cycles, you know. This is our country. This is it. You know, you can always, you can move to Canada, you can leave. Yeah, I'm not going to leave. I'm going to stay here and try to be part of the solution and part of the process.
See if we can get a couple more questions in. Yami?
You asked all your questions. She sat with us at dinner.
So you just mentioned the democratic process and the electoral system. So among both my classes and professors and among my peers, there's been talk about the discrepancy between votes overall and the electoral college. I'm just wondering for both of you, whether you think the electoral college is still a really important function of the American democracy, or if it's something of the past that we need to move on from and replace with a different sort of vote count.
Questions about the Electoral College and whether it still makes sense in contemporary America.
The Electoral College is an anachronism, and it needs to be abolished, in my opinion. And there is a movement called the National Popular Vote, where you have to get a number of state legislatures to sign off on resolutions.
Is Michigan
once
wrong?
You get Michigan is Michigan's.
It wasn't a gotcha question.
No. I know. I'm actually trying to think because it may have actually happened since I left, but it wasn't. It wasn't there when I was there. But you have to get the number of states that equal 270 electoral votes to sign on to this, and then in December when the electors meet, the electors pledge to support the person who got the most actual votes. Ideally, you would do it as a constitutional amendment, but as you all know, a constitutional amendment is super hard to get. So the National Popular Vote, called NPV, is a way to try to get to that result without having to do a full constitutional amendment.
Senator?
I mean, I don't think all the votes are actually counted yet. I've been so tired and we've been so busy doing things. Is it gonna be that Hillary won the popular vote?
Yes.
She didn't win them. Well, she didn't win a majority, it wasn't over 50%. So when you win, I guess the Electoral College is great. When you lose, it's terrible. Is it a check and balance that was put in place to protect the smaller states so they have a voice? Yeah. Is it obsolete? Maybe. But is it a conversation we can have in academia? Sure. Can we have it at our breakfast and dinner tables when you're not in academia? Absolutely. It's a fascinating question. And I'm going to, when this is all over, I'm going to kind of go back to, my history. I was a history major at Tufts, and, this is something we obviously, in poli-sci, was very, I'm going to try to figure it out and have a better understanding of it and see, where we go from here. I don't have an answer, quite honestly.
I just want to clarify, I was in favor of it before this election.
I would have said that before or after. So it doesn't matter that we won or lost. I'm just not sure yet.
Try to get a couple more in. Yeah, sir.
Thank you for taking my question.
These are all students.
I'm not a student here, but I'm a grandparent paying for a student to be here. So I feel your pain. I feel that the election now has gone on for 18 months plus 2 days from what we've heard tonight. So my question is democracy continuing to be served by the length of the campaign season? Why do we need 18 months with all of the technology that we have to get the messages out? Can't we shorten it and make it less costly and make more people participate and maybe deal with some of the Supreme Court issues in terms of the challenges? What's wrong with shortening the campaign?
The question is about the length of the campaign season and why does it need to take so long?
Shorten it, please.
So I'm a term limits guy. I always have been. I think the congressional terms are too short, 2 years. You're running, you get in, you work for 6 months, and then you're raising money forever. Senators are a little different, but you're there for, and I remember being there, and they would literally wheel in Strom Thurmond, and they would go like this. I mean, really? Is that what it's come down to? You have people in there for 40, 50, 60 years. That's not what our founding fathers wanted, so I'm more of a traditionalist in that respect. So I believe in term limits. I believe 2 terms for Senate, 6 terms for Congress, so 12 years. And then when you're talking about the actual process, in some countries they actually do that. We're different than most countries. We have freedom of speech. We have the ability for people to do and say and practice whatever they want. And that's the issue. So while you want to do certain things and restrict certain things, you're going to lose the thing that makes us, great. So I don't have an answer. I think I have more of an answer when it comes to the congressional seats than I do with the presidency.
Governor, I would just say, just very quickly, I think we're great, not because of the length of our elections. I think we're great, but I think we'd be even greater if we had shorter elections. And you know, in Canada, the last election that they had when they elected Justin Trudeau, it was 61 days, and the Canadians were furious that it took so long. Wouldn't it be great? And in some states, they have, you know, limitations in terms of when the election can start. So it has, you know, it has been able to pass constitutional muster, as we say. So I would so love it if there were some way, and I don't know if you need a constitutional amendment for it, or if you could do it federally, federal elections, but I would so love a way of shortening these elections.
Take another couple. Yeah, Hugh.
Can I say something? We're going to be out there after, so you guys are welcome to come up to us and ask us whatever we want. So just FYI.
I think your luck of the draw is probably easier than fighting the line, sir. My name is Landon Marchant, and I'm a United States Air Force veteran. And I'm wondering, when you speak about care for citizens, this is to both of you, what do you think will happen with the Veterans Affairs system, especially since so many veterans are LGBTQ and people of color who feel extremely disenfranchised, and the VA system has been bloated but also underfunded?
Questions about what's going to happen to the VA, especially in light of the fact that some veterans are LGBT or of color, and how that affects how it goes from here.
And I would say this is a perfect question to ask Senator Brown, because rumors are out there about how he may serve, and I've read it. He hasn't said anything, or maybe a little, but I think that he may be in contention for a position.
Well, when you take the head of the DNC, I'll take the head of the VA. How about that? Well, first of all, thanks for serving. I served for 35
years.
Yes,
thank you for serving.
Started after the blizzard of 78 that many of you older people remember. That's when I joined and retired as a colonel, last four in the Pentagon. And I worked, actually, on the Don't Ask, Don't Tell. I was the lead person, as you probably know, to get rid of that in our military. And what was it wasn't about being gay or straight for me. It was about how does it affect the mission, and would changing the policy in the military, which is has a specific job, it's not to, you know, to go out and lobby, it's to protect and defend. And would changing the policy affect the morale and affect our readiness and our ability for people to protect us and maybe have to kill and or die for us? And I looked at it that when people were coming home maimed or injured or killed, people weren't looking to say whether they were gay or straight. They were looking to say, for me at least, whether they served their country well. So I did that. So in terms of the VA, they've come leap years, and the biggest issue was dealing with the readiness. For everybody who was involved, it was about readiness, and it did pass. So that issue, I think, has been resolved. When you're talking about women, let's talk about women. I was the person who led the charge to allow women to be in combat and to have the same opportunities as men. Now people say, oh, that's terrible. Well, some people say it's terrible because women are in combat roles and God forbid they get captured and they get, you know, obviously, you know, violated and whatever, or to see your baby, my baby, in a body bag, oh, that's terrible. On the one hand, oh, that's terrible because we can't have women in the military because they're, you know, they just don't like it, the chauvinists, whatever. I've always felt, once again, it comes down to the mission. Can the women that you served with and the women that I served with, can they hit the standards? So when I'm hurt, that she can carry me out of battle. That's all I care about. And if they can, then hey, they should have the same opportunities. And it was pretty interesting to see the challenges to actually get that through. I was like the first guy. And you do that by doing research, speaking to the leaders on the ground, the generals on the ground, the men and women serving on the ground. Yeah, the VA is totally screwed up, okay? Totally screwed up. You have people dying, you have people lying, getting bonuses, and not doing their jobs. And it needs to have a total and complete rehab, top to bottom review, streamline, consolidate, and kick out the dead wood. The problem is it's so strong union, civil service union, that you can't do it. The Senate, they passed a bill finally after people died. The guy hasn't fired anybody, maybe one person. McDonald hasn't fired one guy yet. All right? So you have people who are calling to get help on hotlines who are suicidal and they can't get through. It's unbelievable. They're calling to get help. When you have, I'll tell you, and I know I'm going on, but this is very, I'm very passionate about this. I had a soldier come in. He lost his arm, his leg, and his leg down to here. He and his wife came in for a hearing, and he was from Massachusetts, and he came in for a hearing saying he almost killed himself. If he had limbs, he would do it. All right? And he called the hotline. His wife called the hotline. We need help. 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 And they didn't give him any help. This is a guy who basically is functioning only because of the desire to stay alive, and they blew him off. Imagine what they're doing with guys with PTSD and the like. So there needs to be a complete rehab of that program. And the one reason I supported Donald Trump was because of his commitment, and Hillary too, and many other people, but specifically on this very important issue.
Governor, you want to speak to the VA before we take one last question?
Speak to this issue of, I was going to actually flip a little bit on service. On service broadly, we're here at this college, and a lot of you millennials may be disenchanted by the political system. You may hate it. You may decide that you're never going to be interested in running for office. And we so desperately need a really great bench of millennials. It is a form of service to your country, different than the kind of service that you engaged in, but a form of service nonetheless. And many young people say, why would I want to put my toe into the puranic waters of politics? And I would say, because your country needs you. We need to have your voice, and we need to have your passion. And I hope that wherever you are, and it may not be when you're still a millennial, I mean, you'll always be a millennial, but it may not be when you're, you know, when you're under 30 or under 35, maybe it's not at the right time, but at some point in your life, I pray that you will consider public service because we so need you.
We're gonna take one more question.
Yeah. So in 8 years, there will be 2 fresh candidates from either party. And how do you think that your respective parties are going to evolve in those 8 years, specifically to the governor, about what you're saying about the disenchantment with a lot of working class people, and to the senator about the acceleration of acceptance of a lot of kind of social progress things that a lot, or at least some people think are,
the question is how each of our guests thinks that his or her party is going to evolve over the next 8 years.
I think that my party is going to internalize a bit of Bernie Sanders to say we are going to fight for college affordability. We are going to fight for people so they have jobs here. We're not gonna allow these unfair trade agreements or the hollowing out of the middle class to continue. So I think the lesson from Bernie Sanders, his strength and his clarity and the simplicity of the issue will be part of our DNA. I think that part of our DNA will also be elevating people of color and women and embracing this fabulous, diverse American exceptionalism, which is our diversity. So I think those two issues, income inequality / jobs, and seeing evolution in our party's inclusion, I think will be critical. And all of that sort of rests on the bed of who is coming behind, which is the millennials. You guys have to be part of building up both of our parties, depending on where you are. And I think your voices will be the voices that will be heard in 8 years. Your priorities will be the priorities that are heard in 8 years. And something tells me that you all are going to have a big say in making sure that we do address income inequality and jobs in America and diversity.
Senator?
So this is something I think about a lot, actually. And I'm not a fortune teller. I can't read into the future 8 years. But I'll take both parties. I try to do an analysis on both parties. I think there's going to be actually different parties than the traditional Democrat or Republican Party after what happened. Because you look, listen, I know Bernie Sanders. I serve with Bernie Sanders. I don't agree with him on anything at all. Completely, totally different. But the one thing I love about Bernie Sanders is that he's a man of his word, and I respect the hell out of him for that. Going in front of the American people when no one would take on the Clinton machine and tell people exactly what he thought. It wasn't what I thought, but I respect the hell out of him, and the way that, with all respect, your party treated him was completely and totally unacceptable. That's why I think there's gonna be a ripping apart of the Democratic Party. You're gonna have the Sanders-Warren wing. You're gonna have the maybe the Blue Dog Union, more traditional, working Democrat wing. And in our party, we have, with all respect, you have, you know, the establishment, you know, the Ryan, the McConnells, the Washington insiders who are in a bubble and have no clue what's going on in iron working, you know, car producing Michigan or rural, you know, Williamstown. And then you have the new breed, the people who are basically, you know, they're anti-establishment, they're tired of the swamp, as they say, and they're not going to take it anymore. And I think you're going to have, in our party, it's a little bit different, because you have, I'll just take New Hampshire, for example. In New Hampshire, you have the free staters, you have the Democrat, you have the Republicans, you know, like the fiscal conservatives, the social conservatives, the Second Amendment people, the pro-life, pro-choice, moderates and liberals within our party, and they all hate each other. They all hate each other. And that's why Kelly Ayotte lost, because the Second Amendment people and the never and the pro-Trump people didn't vote for her because she was against Trump. So it's all the difference between the Democrat Party and the Republican Party is that you guys, as you said, the shades, you guys will vote, and you usually, until today, until this election, would just vote for the candidate and just go, and you just vote. The Republican Party, if you don't hit a Republican purity test, which I have failed, I guess, I didn't know there was a test, if you're not pure, then they basically say, see you later, next. And that's the problem with our party. We're not inclusive, we're getting more inclusive, as evidenced by what we were talking about, the don't ask, don't tell, women in the military. I'm all in favor of giving women, you know, higher or equal pay. I did it in my office. I paid women much, much more than I did the men. But when Bernie Sanders and when you guys had the control, when you guys, I don't know what's so funny, but it's true. when the Democrats had control before I got there, they had 2 years to do it and they didn't do it. So there were opportunities missed. So plenty of blame to go around, plenty of opportunities to do Monday morning quarterbacking, but I think you're gonna have almost four different parties, plus the Libertarian, plus the Green Party, Jill Stein wing. It's gonna be fascinating what happens in the next election.
Well, I'm afraid we've reached the appointed time. A reminder that we will adjourn to a reception in the lobby. Before we do so, though, please join me in thanking both Governor Granholm and Senator Brown. Thank you all.